my objective that at the end that you will be able to appreciate and understand more how the cardiac impulses are generated, conducted in the heart, and picked up by that of the ECG. Despite the advances in cardiovascular diagnostics, we know that the ECG remains to be a procedure of choice in the evaluation of patients with chest pain, palpitation, syncope, dizziness, or lightheadedness. It is appropriate for patients with known cardiovascular disease or dysfunction, and in patients suspected of having or at increased risk for cardiovascular disease as part of their initial evaluation, follow-up, and even for preoperative stratification. It is likewise appropriate for a subset of patients with no apparent cardiovascular disease, like, for example, patients who would undergo pre-participation screening prior to sports participation, and even for patients who would need the screening for pre-employment clearance. First, I'd like to emphasize that ECG interpretation should not be difficult, and it can be easy as long as we have a systematic approach on how we look at the ECG. This lecture is not going to be encompassing, and I would still advise you to have further readings on this one, but I would try to lay the foundation and framework wherein you can build your skill and the confidence in reading the ECG. So reviewing the cardiac conduction system, we know that they are specialized conduction tissue that not only generates the cardiac impulses, but also facilitates conduction of the impulses throughout that of the entire heart. The cardiac impulse will be generated in that of the SA node, which is located between that of the superior vena cava and the right atrium. It is an epicardial structure around 8 to 10 millimeters, and it has blood supply nearly equally coming from that of the right coronary artery and the left circumflex artery. It also has a rich autonomic innervation both from the parasympathetic and the sympathetic nervous system. It generates electricity at a range of 60 to 100 in the resting state, and this cardiac impulse will be conducted to the next node, which is that of the atrioventricular node, through that of the internodal tracts. We have the anterior of Thorel, the middle internodal tract, and the posterior internodal tract of Wenckebach. Now, the impulses from the right atrium will likewise be conducted to that of the left atrium via that of the Bachmann's bundle. So it's not really that of the passive conduction through that of the septum in the atria, but it is through a specialized conduction system, again, coming from the right atrium, going to that of the left atrium. Now, the AV node is similar to that of the SA node, that it is also a latent pacemaker, albeit the production is around 40 to 60 beats per minute only. It also has a specialized pacemaker cells, and the AV node is the only electrical connection from that of the atrium and that of the ventricle, or the both the atria and that of the ventricles. So any other electrical connection connecting the atria and the ventricles will be abnormal, and we term them accessory pathways. The AV node is supplied, the vascular supply would mainly come from that of the right coronary artery in around 80 to 85% of cases. So it is not unusual to see that in patients with inferior infarction involving the right coronary artery, that they may present at some point some degree of atrioventricular block. Now, the AV node will continue on to the His bundle. It will pierce the upper part of the septum, going initially to the left and going back to the right. And they will divide into that of the right bundle branch and that of the left bundle branch going to the left ventricle. We also know that the left bundle branch will further subdivide into that of the anterior and posterior fascicles. So again, the conduction system, the impulse formation is they are processes which are very coordinated and requires that of the specialized conduction system. So when it comes to that of the cardiac action potential, of course, we are quite familiar with that of the ventricular cardiomyocyte. It has five phases, phase zero, which is the rapid depolarization, phase one, which is the early after depolarization, phase two, which is the plateau phase, phase three will be repolarization, and phase four will be that of the resting membrane potential. In resting myocyte, the resting membrane potential is around 70 millivolts, But when it's at the cardiac myocyte will be stimulated with application of a positive energy, the voltage-gated sodium channel will open, facilitating rapid sodium entry through rapid sodium channels. By the way, the deflections in that of the cardiac action potential are mainly driven with the transfers of electrolytes across the channels that they are being conducted. So again, going back, the rapid depolarization will be facilitated or mediated by the rapid sodium channel in the heart, in the cardiac myocyte. The sudden closure of the sodium channels with opening of the transient outward currents, I'm sure you're familiar or you have might have seen the ITO, which basically allows potassium to come out, will produce the notch or the early after depolarization or phase one. It will be followed by the opening of the calcium channel, and calcium will now enter the cell, making it more positive at the plateau phase, and that will be the phase two of the cardiac action potential. The closure of the calcium channel will be followed by the opening mainly of that of the rapid potassium channel, the IKR, and then of course the slow potassium channel, the IKS, and they will allow potassium to come out, making the potential of the cell more negative as it goes to that of the resting membrane potential. This, on the right side of the panel, you will see a different waveform, which is the action potential we see in specialized conduction tissue. So you will see this waveform in the sinus node, in the AV node, and even in the His Purkinje system. Notably, you can see marked differences between the two action potentials. Instead of having five phases, it would only have three: phase zero, phase three, and phase four. The major differences, you will see that phase zero, the rapid depolarization, is not as rapid as we see it in the cardiac myocyte. You will see here that in the conduction tissue, the depolarization or the phase zero is not as rapid because this part is mediated by the fast and the slow calcium channel type. Though the fast calcium channel would conduct calcium fast, it is not as fast as the sodium channel. And you will see here that in this part, it would be followed by repolarization with the opening of the potassium channels. And it will go down not really to the resting membrane potential, because instead of being isoelectric, you can actually part wherein it is rapidly upsloping. And this is the pacemaker current mediated mainly by another sodium channel, which is that of the Fanny current or the IF current. These channels were discovered in 1979 by Di Gaglio and Di Francesco, and they described it well. And we know that majority of the pacemaker action potential of pacemaker cells, specifically or predominantly at least in that of the sinus node, the phase four, will be mediated by these channels. So the generation and recording of the ECG when it comes to the complexes, they are not picking up that of the conduction tissue, but rather the polarization of the cardiac myocyte because they are bigger. You will see here that what we know as the P wave will correspond to atrial muscle depolarization. The QRS will correspond to that of the ventricular muscle depolarization, and the repolarization pattern, of course, will be reflected with the ST segment and the T wave in that of the ECG. Now, the repolarization of the atrial cardiac myocyte are too small to actually be detected by that of the surface ECG. That's why the PR segment is that of isoelectric. Okay. So we need to thank really the person who made the ECG available to us and gave us the window or the capacity to see the electrical activity of the heart. And Willem Einthoven recorded the first ECG recording using this machine with the salt solution for better conductibility in a patient in 1903. But of course, he began his work prior to that, years prior to it. And he actually, when he recorded the initial complexes of the ECG, it is not similar to the PQRST wave that we are well aware of now. In fact, initially, he was able to record these complexes with amplitude and over time in the y-axis. You will see here a positive wave followed by a trough, another positive wave, then it goes down to go into another positive wave, which he terms the A wave, the B wave, the C wave, and that of the D. So it did not really start as having PQRST. Now, they realized during that time that the friction of the paper was actually limiting the deflection of the needles. So what they did was to reduce the friction and coming up now with a different wave form, which is what we know now as that of the P, which is the positive deflection with troughs, another positive deflection with trough again, and another positive deflection. So now we have P, which is represents atrial depolarization. We have the QRS complex. The first negative wave was labeled as Q. The first positive was labeled as R. The second negative was labeled as S. And conventionally, the second positive is labeled as R prime. Of course, the repolarization, the T wave is labeled as T wave. Now, you might wonder why PQRST and why not they use the previous ABCD. Well, they did not really use the ABCD because it was representing a different waveform and it was already taken during that time. Now, why not the other letters? Well, primarily because during that time, the other letters were already taken up by other mathematical equations, and the PQRST were the remaining letters in the alphabet. Another popular theory why the ECG waves are labeled PQRST is that most mathematical formulae start with the P, and this is the tradition since the time of Descartes, who was a mathematician and the father of analytic geometry. Thank you for watching the video. If you like similar contents, please consider subscribing to my channel. Like and share the video and hit the notification bell for future updates. Again, this is Dr. Erdi, your Pinoy EP.